Before we talk about all the healing stuff, let's just talk about your transformed life. You were a corporate executive. You had the life of a jet setter. And then what happened? How did you get from there to being this vibrational healer?
Many people in this room already know me. Does anybody not know me? Tonight we have, according to the last head count, 58 bowls in the room. Sometimes I work with 80 bowls. And we also have other sound making instruments. We have some yak bells, some tinctures. Some of you might be familiar with this to awaken consciousness. Also some rattles from Peru. This is a little sacred instrument that the shamans in Peru use. This is actually bamboo from the sanctuary of Machu Picchu. And the Tibetan bowls, or the Himalayan bowls. So these bowls that I'm using are all handmade bowls. They're made traditionally from seven metals. They're made without any machine tooling or without any type of electricity, so to speak. They have a very different spiritual frequency and resonance. And it's constantly being hit, beaten into shape, like this. And so they're not perfectly smooth. So they're a little bit like us. We're not perfectly smooth. So the bowl, in a way, really speaks to our humanity. My traditions are very much Tibetan Buddhism and Peruvian shamanism. So I understand that we kind of have these hooks that stick out of us, like a hook of greed or envy or fear or jealousy, and they're like these little things that stick out of us, and as we walk around in life, those hooks kind of get caught up in things. So if I have a hook for a jealousy, I might sort of attract that into my life, and sort of it'll get hooked onto me, and then I'm carrying it with me for a while. The bowls have this smoothness, and the sound is very round. It's a very smooth sound. And I feel like when we hear the sound of the bowls, it's like all of those hooks that are sticking out of us, which are potent, profound human lessons, they kind of integrate back into us. So when I do the first round, and we'll do two or three rounds, where you'll be listening, integrating. In the first round, I would invite you just to think personally about what are your hooks. Wow, there's tons of cucumbers. You guys like cucumbers? Can I hand them off to you?
Mm-hmm.
Here you go. These cucumbers are from the garden. They're gigantic. Delicious. We're going to have them We're going to feed the film crew some. She got stuck. Here, Namek, Namek, Namek. Come on, Namek, come on, Namek. Oh, Jesus. Come on, sweetheart. Come on. You're too cute. Oh, she's too cute. You want to go outside? Come on, outside, outside. Outside, out you go, out you go. Woof! Hey, 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 little Vishla.
Just as we're coming in. Oh, it's on the echinacea flower just here. Oh. Wow, that's a gorgeous butterfly. It's still there.
Well, there's a monarch now, over here, visiting us.
Where?
Just down here. Here he is. Up, up, up.
Oh. Tell us about who we're visiting
here. Kenshin Rinpoche. Okay. So Kenshin Rinpoche just celebrated his 90th birthday. And he is one of the oldest living Tibetan masters. And he has been the teacher of the heads now that are the
Karmapa, the 17th Karmapa.
In this school of Buddhism, we receive a transmission, which is an energetic transmission that's given from the teacher. And certain teachers are holders or keepers of this wisdom and this energy field. And they give you the transmission, which is the energetic information. And it gives you permission and they give you instruction on how to do a particular practice. So I've been in this lineage for, since I was a kid, since I was like 12 or something. But very seriously, I took the refuge or the Bodhisattva vow actually the day that I was fired by George Soros. That's a really nice transition, that one. Okay, so we want to get some flowers for Rinpoche. Is it okay if we're filming?
Yeah.
Yep.
Are we filming?
They're making a documentary about me. It's about spirituality. Like, what's the meaning of life?
Oh.
Things like that.
Nice.
So what would you like to...
I don't know if you want to do a prayer or meditation or just as a way to see you activate this room a bit, because I think it relates really well to the altar.
See me activate this room a bit?
Yeah.
Okay. In Tibetan meditation, we cross the right hand on top of the left and we put the thumbs together like that. And then your hands are resting gently on your seat. And then we just dip the head a little bit slightly in and we put the tongue to the top of the roof of the mouth. And allow the mind to become quiet. Allow the mind to settle into a place of spaciousness. And if you have a very busy mind, if the mind is just constantly racing and you can't find a little gap to be peaceful, then what you can do is just concentrate on the breath. You can slowly start to take a few deeper breaths.
bringing awareness back into the physical body. So I've never done this before, but I've always wondered if there's an energy field around it. Thank you. Gracias, Pachamama. Gracias, Pachapapa. Gracias, Manindi. Thank you to all of my ancestors. Thank you to all of my teachers. Thank you to my families of love. Gracias. Okay. Woof. And we're off.
Imagine for an instant television in the United States would take over. And I think you will have imagined the end of history. I will submit to you the hypothesis that a new situation in the image culture is about to happen.
Hey, AB camera speed, slate it.
Okay, Suzy, you're, we're just going to start with an introduction.
So my name is Suzy Mazzoli. I am from Australia. My parents are both Hungarian, mother and father. They both left Hungary in what we would say dire conditions to come to Australia. They met there and I was born along with my brother. So we're first generation Australians. And when I was 21 years old, I went back to the motherland, back to Hungary, to do my master's degree in fine arts at the Hungarian Academy of Fine Arts, and then began working at the Museum of Fine Arts, or the Museum of Contemporary Art, the Műcsarnok, as a curator, and got involved with what was then a very small program, funded by the Soros Foundation in Hungary. And from that point, I had an opportunity, an opening, had great freedom to develop something there, which then became the multinational 20-plus country SCCA, Soros Centres for Contemporary Arts Network.
Dear loved ones, we are here. We are here as always. This is not a return. This is just a re-emergence to the superficial realm upon which you know us as. So let us just take a few moments to recalibrate the energy, to allow us to find a space where we can commune together in what we might call a more peaceful or harmonious state.
And I remember calling up George and asking, could I please go to Sarajevo? I would like to go and do anything I can. We don't have a center there now. Maybe we will have one later on, but can I please go there as a cultural something? Could I please go and assist in some way? So he was in touch with the foundation people there that had obviously some sort of emergency program going there. And they said, yes, come, and maybe I could give some talks. They wanted me to give some lectures on contemporary art. So they said, come and do some lectures. And I said, well, what should I bring? And they said, bring tampons and bring chocolate and bring whiskey. So I remember having like a backpack full of tampons, chocolate and whiskey, and a huge backpack. And I caught a train from Budapest to Zagreb. And then in Zagreb, the foundation had organized for me to get onto a UN carrier aircraft to fly into Sarajevo. And I was flying with military. I was the only civilian on the plane. I flew in with military, you know, like I was going backpacking in, you know, the Adirondacks or something. I flew in and it was winter time. It was very cold. And as the plane landed, we were under attack, and there was gunfire and things happening. And the soldiers told me to jump out of the plane and to crawl along the ground and to crawl into one of the APCs, one of the armoured personnel carriers. And the gentlemen, the soldiers in the tank were very friendly and asking me what I was doing. And I said, oh, I'm coming to teach about contemporary art in Sarajevo. They thought that I was completely mad.
And you can feel your humanness, perhaps even the emotional body dissolving somewhat. Things lose their charge. Historical events become almost insignificant. And the being is now present in a state that penetrates deeply through the core of Earth and reaches up far into the infinite universe. The consciousness tapping into the various realms of Earth, the realm of minerals, of gases, of land forms, of animals, of plants, of humans. And the human mind, the human consciousness now expands out into all of the fields of this earth, reaching through the dimensions. So as we work together with you, many of you are very familiar with our practice. Allow yourself to be here in the present moment with us. At the same time now, allow the restrictions of three dimensions just to dissolve. We are speaking with you, entering into this conversation now at a field that is not necessarily the field that we compose ourselves within. So there is a meeting place between us and you, an energetic meeting place, where you would be, for example, expanding the frequency to meet with us. So it requires your expansion, it requires your coming to the table, so to speak, as well.
As a young boy, you might have been told by your father, you know, what happens after death, and he, as you know, as a scientific mind or as an atheist, might have said nothing, you know, that at the end of life, that's it, completion.
She's telling my story right now.
By the way, and but it's, you know, it's something that many people have been told when they're young children, and. But then you go to school and you study science, and the science teacher says that energy is beginningless and endless. So we know by physically being here that we are beginningless and endless.
So we are making this sound temple for the highest good of all beings everywhere.
So we're good to go.
So are there any entity attachments now with Aaron? Yes. So I'm getting a yes. Is there one? So there's two. So what we'll do is, so these entity attachments are there in your body, and are they affecting you? Yes. So what I'm going to do, with your permission, is liberate those into a more free, more open space where they're no longer suffering. And we will speak about the world, we will speak about yourselves, we will speak about ourselves. But to have this conversation, we require space. We require an open space where there are no concepts, no fear, no judgments, no restrictions. And we are now beginning to arrive in that place. The place that exists and does not exist, that is in the moment, of the moment. And in this place we experience what is experience. Now you are having this experience of the self, perhaps the expanded energetic self.